Hello. Hello, everyone. Welcome back. Welcome back to the visual question and answering and dialogue workshop. Hope you all had a good chance to check out the posters for this session. We'll resume with our talks. Our next speaker is Sanja Fidler. Sanja is an assistant professor at the University of Toronto and a director of AI at NVIDIA Toronto. Amongst a lot of things Sanja works on, most related to the workshop are her works in the interplay of language and vision, which include generating sentential descriptions about complex scenes, as well as using textual descriptions for better scene parsing. Today, she'll be talking about compositional learning of complex tasks. Look forward to your talk, Sanja. Thank you.
Yeah, the title is kind of random. Don't pay attention to it. All right, so I'm going to touch on different topics of vision and language today. And yeah, the first topic I wanted to talk about is the fact that, you know, people are multitasking. And you've seen this in this VQA where you have this navigation task and, you know, robots need to learn actually multiple tasks, right? And maybe we don't even realize, but humans perform very different tasks every day, right? So for me to come to CVPR, I need to at least know how to walk, maybe pack, navigate to the airport, somehow communicate at the airport to actually onboard the right plane, you know, commute in a, you know, behave yourself when we commute, maybe eat and drink, and then, you know, frantically work on the slides. Right, so people are very multitasking, but in the current works, most works actually address just a single task, right? There's been obviously, you know, different works trying to do multiple tasks, right? So the easiest thing is just to train one task and then fine tune on a new task, or somehow fork the features from the previous task and just somehow, you know, train the residual feature that you need to solve a new task and so on. This is the topic of, for example, progressive neural networks, right? What I'm gonna argue here is that, you know, these tasks that we design to teach, you know, machines should somehow more directly benefit from each other. We shouldn't just reuse features from the other task, we should actually be using their outputs. Right, so for example, every of these tasks has been specially designed by humans to be, first of all, interpretable and to be useful. Right, so why are we throwing that information away? We should actually be using all those outputs as well. Okay, so that's one point. And the other point is that, you know, humans learn tasks in somehow progressive manner. Right, we don't start in teaching the kid to do all this difficult trigonometry and so on. Right, we actually start with teaching them what numbers mean, maybe add numbers, and then somehow progressively learn more and more complex things. Right, so we should kind of build knowledge in a compositional way, because if you do it that way, you can actually reuse whatever you have learned from the previous task in the new task. Right, so we can take, you know, visual reasoning as one example of this, right? So if I have a question, what is the dog looking at? You can very easily break this down into much simpler tasks, right? For example, first you need to locate the object in the image, you know, then which object is actually the dog, and then, you know, which object is the dog looking at, right? And then you wanna just produce the name of that object, okay? So that's just the point. Lots of tasks we're already solving can be broken down into simpler tasks, okay? There is an analogy to writing code or programs. Yes, you can just write one function that solves your complicated task, and, you know, even if something repeats, I'm just gonna write it again and again and again, right? But much better a way to write code is to make it modular, right? And actually this complex program calling functions that solve like sub problems of this more complicated task, okay? So I'm gonna introduce this work that we recently did. It was a paper at Eichler that tries to somehow take all these intuitions into account, okay? So in progressive module networks, that's how we call them, we wanna learn tasks in somehow progressive level of complexity. Okay, so imagine we have a very simple task. You have an input, we're gonna call it a query, and it produces some interpretable output. Well, this could just be object classification, for example. And now we wanna build a new compositional task on top that can learn how to query the simpler task and then get the output as, you know, get their output and then use that output to do reasoning on top. Okay, and you can think of that process just being compositional. So I can add another task on top that's calling this more, you know, simpler task, which calls the other task, and so on, right? But basically, they're communicated at the input-output level, right? So it's learning to generate the input to the other task, and it's learning to use their output in its own reasoning process, right? So if you would unroll some more complicated, let's say, module here, right? So you have a more complicated module in the top trying to solve a more complicated task. It's going to, in this case, call three different modules. M0 is kind of the simpler task, so you can still query that task and get its output. It can call a module, which is a little bit simpler, but not the simplest. And that module can, again, call simpler task, which is M0 in this case. So you can kind of get this full recursion tree when you're solving the more complex task. Is that clear? It's basically like code, but we're doing it at a module level. And these modules, in our case, are going to be neural networks. OK? So let me kind of visualize what I'm talking about here. So the terminal modules can be kind of thought of as the base cases in a recursion function. So these are like the most simplest tasks that you can think of, okay? You know, like one simple task would just be, you know, you're given a box around an object and you need to classify the class of that object, okay? Or, you know, attribute classification is another example. You want to name the attributes of that object inside the bounding box. Okay, compositional model is any other module in this module network, okay? And it's basically defined by having some sort of order list of all the other existing tasks, which are kind of organized into levels, levels kind of denoting the complexity of the task. And each of these compositional models also has a catch-all residual model. So whatever is not encoded, whatever knowledge is not represented in all the other existing library of tasks, it has the chance to still learn it in a more direct path, okay? So what do these compositional modules kind of do? Okay, so one feature that it have is something called a query transmitter. So it's basically, so every task is kind of a recurrent controller, and in each state of this, let's say RNN, whatever, is going to produce a query to each of the lower level tasks. And this query is essentially trying to translate into the input to that other task, okay? And then it's going to receive whatever output it receives, and it's projecting onto, you know, some useful latent space that it's going to be using in its own internal module, okay? So that's basically query and receiving. And it, again, it's at the input-output level. And then we also have an importance function, which is basically saying how much of all these other tasks that I'm calling are contributing to my own reasoning process, right? So I might not be finding use in each of these other tasks. I might just focus on some of them. So this is kind of like a soft attention of all the other existing tasks, okay? And then there is a state update, so you have this controller that now receives kind of the aggregated information from all the other tasks, and then update its state, and then possibly do another loop calling the tasks. And then it finally just outputs the prediction, okay? So, you know, conceptually, this is a very simple algorithm, right? So you're doing a bunch of loops in the recurrent controller of the task, and now you're calling, you're producing a query based on a current state, you're receiving the output, and then you do some sort of a soft weighted, you know, latent representation, and then do whatever reasoning to produce the output. Okay? So how do we train this? We train the modules one at a time, from the simplest to more complex. So we kind of manually define what's the simplest task, then what's level one, level two, and so on, and we train them in a progression, right? Because every more complex task is using the simpler ones, okay? When we train the next task, we keep the lower level fixed. It's just for convenience, maybe, because we don't want them to completely diverge from the original task, and we really want this new task to just reuse and then learn whatever residual it needs, okay? And all of them are neural nets, so everything is backpropable and so on. So for example, for visual reasoning here, you know, at the simplest level, level zero, I have just object classifier or attribute classifier. Level one would be relationship detection, and I'm going to talk in detail about that. I can have image captioning. More complex task is object counting, because object counting actually relies on understanding relationships and understanding naming of this object. And then the final level is VQA, which really requires this abstract reasoning. Okay? So at the level zero, this would be the object classifier, just taking a box and producing an embedding of the class. Okay? Same for attribute classifier, object in, out the softmax across the different attributes or embedding of those. Level one, image captioning. Why is this level one? Because when I'm taking an image and I start trying to describe it, right, I'm basically focusing on different parts of the image, and I have in mind what I want to talk about, whether I want to produce a noun, whether I want to produce an adjective. And given what I want to produce, I will call the associated simpler module, right? So for example, in this particular case, you know, is this RNN that's trying to produce a sentence. Instead of just producing the embedding, it's going to call the simpler modules. So in the beginning, it's going to call the attribute model because it wanted an adjective. And then this is going to return tall. And then it wants a noun. It's calling the object module. And it's getting back tree. And that's how it basically computes the sentence. Whatever is not a noun or an adjective, it's going to produce with its residual module whatever word it needs. Okay. Relationship detection was put at level one, which basically the input is going to be, you know, the bounding box of the object that I'm looking at, relationship, let's say ride, and in this case I want to get back the rider, so the person on top, right? So this is going to be output by the relationship detector, and it kind of queries whatever lower level modules it has, in this case object and attribute classifier. Object counting is even the next level. Okay, so it's basically, let's just take an example, right? So for example, how many people are sitting on the bench? This is already quite a complicated reasoning process, right? So first what we're gonna do is produce some sort of a query. So how many people are actually, I'm gonna focus on this bench, and now I'm going to query the relationship model. I'm gonna say, you know, the red box, which is this bench, and the relationship sitting on, and you know, this is hopefully going to produce these boxes. And then the object counting model is going to somehow use this information to output three in this case. Okay, so the counting model actually, you know, relied on the relationship module here. And that was the level before. Okay, and then the VQA, which is the final model, module, essentially is calling all the other modules, which recursively again called all the other modules. So here is going to be one example. You know, what is the bird standing on? So this is the full kind of the compositional task tree or module tree, if you will. So let's look at what's happening. Right, so it's basically calling all these modules in the top. What you see below, you probably don't see because it's too small. It's the importance. So in this case, it found the most use in the relationship module and an object classification module, right? So it's first focusing on the bird, and then it's feeding that to the relationship module, which essentially is returning the bench. That is calling now object classifier and attribute, which are saying this is actually the bench. This box is a bench. These are the attributes. And then the counting and captioning module, which in this case have very low importance, which are not actually relevant to this question. And then all this is then combined into answering bench. Okay? So the nice thing about this module is because all these other modules are interpretable, that's how we design them. They're producing outputs that are relevant to people. You can now start looking at all this intermediate reasoning process, right? All the intermediate outputs that were generated by the modules when they were called by this higher level module, okay? And that's what makes kind of the full reasoning process more interpretable. I get a headache when I look at this. Apparently you can decode interpretability here, but I ask my student, can we just convert whatever you see here into sentences, okay? Because basically you have the importance functions telling you what is being active at each time step. Can we just write out some sort of an explanation of what the VQA model actually got as intermediate outputs to do the reasoning? So now this is kind of our attempt for this. So the question, what is behind the man? And then we're trying to use all that information from the intermediate model to generate these sentences. In this case, you know, it's very simple template-based statements. I first find the blue box, and then from that I look at the green box. The object tree would be useful in answering the question. In conclusion, I think the answer is tree. Okay, so you can kind of get this nice explanation out because the modules are so interpretable. Another example, what color is the Kirby wire? Again, some sort of an explanation. We try to compare this to just a baseline, which is just a direct answer, the typical way, question, neural network output. So there's no explanation is associated with those modules. So R is in the middle, and then baseline is on the right. And then we were basically asking mechanical Turkers to just look at these explanations and tell us how well each one is doing in comparison. Okay? So we had four different levels of how good it's doing, where four would be correct answer and, you know, really great reasoning, so the reasoning was fully correct, and one would be, you know, wrong answer and wrong reasoning. Okay? And the Turkers were basically looking at, I think maybe in isolation, the baseline and then our result, and they were grading from 1 to 4. Okay? The nice thing about here, you can see that when the answer was correct for both the baseline and us, we get a higher rating just because the reasoning process was interpretable for humans, so they preferred it more. And then when both of them were actually wrong, they also preferred ours as well a little bit because maybe there was something in the reasoning process that was still correct even though the final answer was wrong, which was, I thought was kind of nice. And of course, then you can check, you know, that every module is actually contributing to the final performance, and you can see that that's actually the case. We were also looking at whether this is going to help us use less data when we're training a more complicated task, just because there's a lot of knowledge already embedded in these other modules that it's using. So you can see from 1% to 100% different breakdowns. So if it's using, for example, 5 or 10% of the data, what's the accuracy gain it's getting over the baseline, which is just direct? Okay, so you can see that with just 1% of data, we're actually behind because it's much harder to memorize in this, you know, very complicated network, which is modular. But then at, you know, reasonable percent, 10%, we're getting like the highest boost, right? It takes a little bit of warm up because these modules essentially need to learn how to query the simpler models, but then it's getting the boost. Okay, so that was kind of like learning multiple tasks, and I want to switch on how can you actually make learning more efficient or with having some sort of interaction, okay? So imagine that, you know, have an agent that is trying to describe images, trying to caption images, right? It's getting this image and it wants to produce a sentence, so the typical way would be you get a human to caption the image for you and the poor machine just repeats, right? And that's how all the data sets were collected. So Coco, 100,000 of images of humans writing captions, and then machine just getting all this data as a supervised task, okay? The question is, can I instead just use, you know, less data and have some sort of a more interactive learning process, okay? So what if we just use 10,000 instead of 100,000? Okay, just train the model on 10,000, kind of a warm up. And, you know, like, this is basically what it gets. It's almost right. It's almost right. It has some common sense errors, but it's almost right with 10% of data. So maybe we can exploit this fact, right? We actually had that evaluated. So, I don't know, quite a large percent is almost perfect or at least acceptable. There's very few that are, not very few, but there's still room for improvement. There's quite a lot already fully correct. Okay? So can we just train this robot on less data? And now it's going to start captioning in the wild. It's going to just be getting images. It's going to try producing captions. And a human is going to look at this robot and it's going to give them some feedback. Right? The typical way that people are doing it is just, you know, a numerical reward saying, you know, from 0 to 1, how well you did. But, you know, I'm going to argue here that it's not a very useful reward. Instead, what if we just give it, you know, feedback in the form of a sentence? Right? So in this particular case, it was almost right. It's just that it's a woman and not a man. Right? So if the feedback was the photo showing a woman playing tennis and not a man, that's so much more useful to someone that's learning. Right? Because I'm essentially solving the credit assignment problem. I'm telling you what in that sentence was wrong and what was correct. Right? So if we can exploit language when we're learning, that's actually a really big plus. Okay, so in this particular case, you know, this would say that a man was incorrect, but if I produce woman, that would be correct. Okay? And here we had a model that can essentially exploit that information. Okay, I'm not going to talk about the details, but I'm just going to say that, you know, if you learn from that kind of data, you can learn a little bit better model. This is in terms of performance. You can do better than if I just give you a more numerical reward. But this model is way more efficient, right? Because essentially, I'm going to be using only 10% of the data, and I'm only going to be, with this one sentence, I can solve a lot more than querying the human all the time. OK? Now, what we wanted to do is to go even one step beyond this. So imagine that now this machine wants to describe this image, but I want to avoid having the human always look over this robot. Okay, so maybe it's already knowing a lot. I don't need to have a babysitter looking at me all the time, right? Maybe it just wants to ask for particular examples it doesn't know the answer to. So for example, this case, it wants to say a woman is playing, but it just doesn't know the sport, right? I don't need someone to write a full answer, like the full caption for me, because I only don't know the sport, right? Just one word is missing. Right, so what if I just generate a question that's useful for me in this case, you know, what is the person playing, and the human is only giving me like a single word, tennis, and I can just plug that tennis in and generate the rest because I know the rest. Right, it doesn't make sense to have all that overhead on the human. Okay, so we had this kind of a model where, you know, you have an image, you caption, or it's trying to produce the caption, and then we have something called decision maker that is essentially looking at each word in this produced sentence, and it is deciding whether am I sure about this word or not, okay? And if it's not sure, in this particular case for that window, it was not sure, it's going to call question generator, which is gonna take into account the image and the current caption, and it's going to produce a question that queries the information from the human in natural language about what this word should have been. Okay, now the human gets that question, it answers, and then you get the answer in, feed that back into the RNN, and it's producing the rest of the sentence. That's kind of the model. I'm not gonna go into the pipeline, it's a fairly complicated problem how you actually train this, because it's more or less a hierarchical error problem, so we're kind of iterating with which model is being trained and so on. But essentially, there's a warm-up state where you train your captioner on some fully labeled data, and then you're training the decision maker and somehow your captioner by having this, you know, QA stage. So in terms of the results, in the bottom, we had humans evaluating how good the questions are. It turns out the questions were over 80% actually useful. Okay, so they were actually meaningful. Sometimes they were completely, non-understandable, so the answer was as a result of non-understandable. But generally they were useful, and the top is essentially how well you can be doing with this type of supervision. Okay, so the ground truth is essentially saying how much of the COCO ground truth we're actually using. We're using the supervision block, which is more than the ground truth because we're actually getting some answers back. So the human has a bit of overhead. So we're cutting that as additional supervision. And then there's performance. right? So in terms of compared to all ground truth, we're actually doing better than if I had everything fully labeled. And it's doing much better than if you just had, you know, that level of ground truth. Okay. Some results, image. This was the original caption. It would have been generated during training. So a giraffe standing in front of a building with a building in the background. So the decision maker was not happy with this particular word. He wanted to ask a question, and it asked, what is the building made of? So it was actually looking for a completely different word. The human answers brick, and then the new caption would be a giraffe standing in front of a brick building. Okay, so that makes more sense. Original caption, a group of people that are standing on a cement surface wasn't happy with that word, and the question was, what is the man doing? Answer, riding an elephant. And a new caption would be a group of people riding an elephant with a large umbrella. So that makes sense, and that becomes like your new training example. And I think I'm out of time, so I'm going to stop here. Yeah. I could be here for hours, but you guys want to stop me. So any questions?
Any questions? Yeah.
Blind as in,
the humans don't know,
doesn't know the picture, or
well,
just...
The humans don't know if the explanation is actually meant for this task or some other task.
Oh, I see. So just like blind out the task.
Indeed.
Yeah, that's a good idea. No, here is just showing, but that's a really good idea, so we should definitely try that. And we could make the explanation actually more comprehensive because it is doing the full recursion, but this was already pretty useful.
Any other question? Okay, let's thank the speaker again.